Ascent Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents HBR's 10 Must Reads on Innovation by Harvard Business Review, Peter F. Drucker, Clayton M. Christensen, and Vijay Govindarajan. Narrated by Susan Larkin and Bryan Brendle. Publisher's note: this audiobook has bonus material. Please contact whomever you purchased this audiobook from to request the material.
The Innovation Catalysts by Roger L. Martin. One day in 2007, midway through a five-hour PowerPoint presentation, Scott Cook realized that he wasn't another Steve Jobs. At first, it was a bitter disappointment. Like many entrepreneurs, Cook wanted the company he had co-founded to be like Apple: design-driven, innovation-intensive, wowing consumers year in and year out with fantastic offerings. But that kind of success always seemed to need a powerful visionary at the top. This article is about how Cook and his colleagues at the software development company Intuit found an alternative to the Steve Jobs model, one that has enabled Intuit to become a design-driven innovation machine. Any corporation, no matter how small or prosaic its business, can make the same grassroots transformation if it really wants to. The birth of the idea. Intuit's transformation arguably began in 2004 with its adoption of the famous Net Promoter Score. Developed by Fred Reichold of Bain & Company, NPS depends on one simple question for customers: how likely are you, on a scale of 0, not at all likely, to 10, extremely likely, to recommend this product or service to a colleague or friend? Detractors answer from 0 to 6. Passives answer 7 or 8, and promoters answer 9 or 10. A company's net promoter score is the percentage of promoters less the percentage of detractors. For the first couple of years, Intuit saw its NPS rise significantly, owing to a number of marketing initiatives. But by 2007, NPS growth had stalled. It was not hard to see why. Although Intuit had lowered its detractor percentage substantially, it had made little headway with promoters. Customer recommendations of new products were especially disappointing. Clearly, Intuit needed to figure out how to galvanize its customers. Cook, a member of Procter & Gamble's board of directors, approached Claudia Kotchka, then P&G's vice president of design, innovation, and strategy, for advice. Following their discussions, Cook and Steve Bennett, then Intuit's CEO, decided to focus on the role of design in innovation at a two-day offsite for the company's top 300 managers. Cook created a one-day program on what he called Design for Delight, D4D, an event aimed at launching Intuit's reinvention as a design-driven company. The centerpiece of the day was that five-hour PowerPoint presentation, in which Cook laid out the wonders of design and how it could entice Intuit's customers. The managers listened dutifully and clapped appreciatively at the end, as they were supposed to. Cook was, after all, a company founder. Nevertheless, he was disappointed by his reception. Despite some interest in the ideas presented, there was little energy in the room. But although the main event fell flat, the one that followed did not. Cook had met a young consulting associate professor at Stanford named Alex Kazix, whom he'd invited to present for an hour at the offsite. Like Cook, Kazix began with a PowerPoint presentation, but he ended his after 10 minutes and used the rest of the time for a participatory exercise. The managers worked through a design challenge, creating prototypes, getting feedback, iterating, and refining. The group was mesmerized. Afterward, Cook informally polled the participants, asking what takeaways they'd gotten from the day-long session. Two-thirds of the lessons they reported came from the hands-on exercise. This reaction made Cook think. He might not be the next Steve Jobs, but perhaps his company didn't need one. Given a few tools, coaching, and practice, could the grassroots of the company drive success in innovation and customer delight? Idea in brief. A few years ago, the software development company Intuit realized that it needed a new approach to galvanizing customers. The company's net promoter score was faltering, and customer recommendations of new products were especially disappointing. Intuit decided to hold a two-day off-site meeting for the company's top 300 managers with a focus on the role of design in innovation. One of the days was dedicated to a program called Design for Delight. The centerpiece of the day was a PowerPoint presentation by Intuit founder Scott Cook, who realized midway through that he was no Steve Jobs. The managers listened dutifully, but there was little energy in the room. By contrast, a subsequent exercise in which the participants worked through a design challenge by creating prototypes, getting feedback, iterating, and refining had them mesmerized. The eventual result was the creation of a team of 9 design thinking coaches, innovation catalysts, from across Intuit who were made available to help any work group create prototypes, run experiments, and learn from customers. The process includes a painstorm to determine the customer's greatest pain point, a soul jam to generate and then winnow possible solutions, and a code jam to write code good enough to take to customers within 2 weeks. Design for Delight has enabled employees throughout Intuit to move from satisfying customers to delighting them. From idea to initiative. Like most Silicon Valley tech companies, Intuit had user interface designers, graphic designers, and others buried relatively deep in the organization. Cook turned to a particularly talented young design director, Karen Hansen, and asked her what she would do to promote design at Intuit. Hansen realized that the company needed an organized program for moving from talking about D4D to doing it. She persuaded Cook to let her create a team of design thinking coaches, innovation catalysts, who could help Intuit managers work on initiatives throughout the organization. Hansen selected 9 colleagues to join her in this role. Their training and deployment was her central agenda for fiscal year 2009. In selecting the 9, Hansen looked first for people with a broad perspective on what it meant to be a designer. Beyond creating a graphic user interface that was both appealing and intuitive, it included thinking about whether the software solved the user's problem in a delightful way. She wanted her coaches to be interested in talking to users and solving problems with colleagues rather than depending solely on their own genius. If they were to successfully coach others in design thinking, they'd need an outgoing personality and good people skills. She invited 2 direct reports from her own business unit and 7 people from other units across the company. The group included 6 women and 4 men. They came from a variety of fields within Intuit: design, research, product management, and had titles such as user interface architect, principal researcher, staff designer, and product manager. Hansen chose people who were influential even though they were all 1 or 2 levels below director, meaning closer to the bottom of the organization than the top. All 9 signed up enthusiastically. To begin building design thinking into the DNA of the company, Cook and Hansen organized a series of Design for Delight forums. These were typically attended by more than 1,000 employees and featured a speaker who'd had exemplary success in creating customer delight. Half the featured speakers came from inside Intuit. The other half included the founding CEO of Flip Video, Facebook's top data scientist, and the head of Apple Stores. The forums also showcased D4D successes to date and shared best practices. People who worked together were encouraged to attend together and were asked as a team to identify the one thing they would do differently after the forum. To ensure that managers who were thinking design didn't become too intimidated to begin the process, or frustrated trying to do something with which they had little experience, or delayed by needing to hire an outside design consultant, Hansen's innovation catalysts were available to help any work group create prototypes, run experiments, and learn from customers. Of course, there was a risk that this would stretch the catalysts too thin, so Hansen placed some constraints on their availability. They were expected to spend 25% of their time on big payoff projects for Intuit overall. Hansen kept in close contact with general managers who had catalysts working with them to make sure that the catalysts were addressing the manager's biggest problems. She realized that if design momentum was to be maintained, her coaches had to be seen as responsible for 3 or 4 visible and high-impact wins a year. Some enabling came from the very bottom of the organization. In 2008, 2 employees who had been at Intuit only 4 months designed an online social network for the D4D initiative, which they rolled out the following year with management's consent, but without its direct support. In its first year, the new platform, named Brainstorm, generated 32 ideas that made it to market. From presentations to experiments. Traditionally, decisions at Intuit had been made on the basis of PowerPoint presentations. Managers would work to produce both what they saw as a great product and a great presentation for selling the concept to their bosses. Under this system, Intuit managers voted on ideas and then tried to sell them to customers. A key component of D4D, therefore, was shifting the focus away from managerial presentations. It would be far better, Hansen and Cook realized, to learn directly from customers through experiments. Today, D4D innovations begin with what Intuit calls the painstorm, a process developed by 2 innovation catalysts, Rachel Evans and Kim McNeely. It is aimed at figuring out customers' greatest pain point for which Intuit can provide relief. In a painstorm, team members talk to and observe customers in their offices or homes rather than sit in Intuit offices and imagine what they want. This exercise often shatters preconceptions. Going into one painstorm for a sales-oriented product, the team was convinced that the product concept should be grow your business. But the painstorm showed that grow your business sounded very ambiguous to customers. It could refer to growing revenues from their existing customers, not a pain point for them, or to acquiring similar small businesses, also not a pain point, but expensive. The true pain point was acquiring entirely new customers through organic sales efforts. Get customers was a winning concept that focused laser-like on that. Recruiting the innovation catalysts. In 2008, Karen Hansen sent this email to some Intuit colleagues. Subject: Phase 2 of Design for Delight. We need you. You have been nominated, and your participation has been approved by your manager to help us drive Phase 2 of Design for Delight at Intuit. You are a critical leader who can enable Intuit to become one of the principal design thinking cultures. We have a number of levers at our disposal, but we need your help to develop even better ideas to drive design thinking deeper into the organization. Here's what you'll be committing to. Actively participate in a one-day brainstorm/workshop in early August to work through what we, as a force of design thinking and as a larger company, might do to take Design for Delight to its next level. Scott will come by and respond to our ideas/plan towards the end of the day. Commit to the execution of initiatives generated through the August workshop. Become a more visible Design for Delight leader across Intuit, e.g., help teach a Design for Delight 101 session/workshop to FastPath or some other such leadership session. Contribute to the D4D body of knowledge through existing and future contribution systems. Be a sounding board for Intuit execs. Be a D4D coach/facilitator that the larger company can draw upon, e.g., coach key teams across Intuit in brainstorming, design reviews, etc. In total, your commitment will be about 2 days/a month, and we'll be able to work around your schedule. Let me know if you are in for fiscal year 09, and I'll get the August date on everyone's calendars. Right now, we're looking at an in-person workshop on August 4th, 5th, or 6th in Mountain View. Next, within 2 weeks, the group holds a soul jam in which people generate concepts for as many product or service solutions as possible to address the pain points they've identified, and then weed the concepts down to a short list for prototyping and testing. In the early days of prototyping, these high-potential solutions were integrated into Intuit's software development process. But the innovation catalysts realized that the best way to maintain momentum would be to get code into users' hands as quickly as possible. This would help determine whether the solution had potential and, if so, what needed to be done to enhance it. So the third step became moving immediately to code jam, with the goal of writing code that wasn't airtight, but was good enough to take to customers within 2 weeks of the soul jam. Thus, proceeding from the pain storm to the first user feedback on a new product usually takes only 4 weeks. Let's look at a couple of examples. When Intuit's tax group began to think about mobile apps, Carol Howe, a product manager in Innovation Catalysts, started with the customer. Her 5-person team went out into the wild, she says, to observe dozens of smartphone users. It quickly narrowed in on millennials, whose income range made them likely candidates for the simplest tax experience. The team created multiple concepts and iterated with customers on a weekly basis. They brought customers in each Friday, distilled what they'd learned on Monday, brainstormed concepts on Tuesday, designed them on Wednesday, and coded them on Thursday before bringing the customers in again. Through these iterations, the team uncovered multiple delighters. They launched a pilot in California in January 2010 and expanded nationwide in January 2011. The resulting application, SnapTax, has 4.5 stars in both the Apple and Android stores and a net promoter score in the high 80s. An even better example comes from India. In 2008, members of the India team came up with an idea remote from tax preparation and other core Intuit North America products, none of which were likely to succeed in India. The idea, a service for poor Indian farmers, was interesting enough for Intuit to give Deepa Bachu, a longtime development manager, the green light to explore it. Bachu and an engineer spent weeks following subsistence farmers through their daily lives, in the fields, in their villages, and at the markets where they sold their produce. The two came to appreciate the farmer's greatest pain point: perishable inventory that either went unsold or got a suboptimal price. If Intuit could enable the farmers to consistently sell their produce before spoilage and at a decent price, their pain would be reduced or eliminated. After the pain storm and the soul jam, the team went into rapid experimentation. Within 7 weeks, it was running a test of what was eventually launched as Mobile Bazaar, a simple text messaging-based marketplace connecting buyers and sellers. To get there so fast, the team had cleverly faked parts of the product that would have been costly and slow to code and build. These came to be known as FACO backends. What the user saw looked real, but behind the user interface was a human being, like the Wizard of Oz behind the curtain, rather than thousands of lines of code that would have taken months to write. The initial trials showed that half the farmers were able to increase their prices by more than 10%. Some of them earned as much as 50% more. Within a year of launch, Mobile Bazaar had 180,000 subscribing farmers, most of them acquired by word of mouth. They report that, on average, the service boosts their prices by 16%. From breakthroughs to culture. Hansen was pleased with the progress of the 10 original innovation catalysts in their first year and with the organization's receptivity, but she knew that Intuit would have to scale up to make the transformation complete. Brad Smith, the new CEO, was raising innovation expectations for the whole company, focusing particularly on new arenas that he described as mobile, social, and global. Hansen set a goal for fiscal year 2010 to select, train, and deploy another 65 catalysts. This meant sourcing from a broader pool of talent, going deeper into product management and engineering, and creating a small dedicated team to support the catalysts and increase D4D pull from mid-level managers. She appointed Suzanne Pelican, one of the original 10, to expand the catalysts' number and capabilities. Hansen had learned from the initial work that the strongest design thinkers didn't necessarily make the best catalysts. She says, We not only needed people who were design thinkers, we also needed people with a passion to give D4D away and help others to do great work versus coming up with a great idea and bringing it to others. The catalysts also needed mutual support. Hansen's team had found that they did their best work when they worked together. They learned new ideas and techniques from one another and provided moral support in tough situations. So as Pelican scaled up the Catalyst Corps, she made sure that each Catalyst was part of an organized posse that typically extended across business units, allowing new methods to travel quickly from one end of the organization to the other. To increase the Catalyst's effectiveness, Hansen established a second small team, led by Joseph O'Sullivan, another of the original 10, to help middle management embrace both design thinking as a concept and the innovation catalysts as enablers. For example, after several catalysts reported encountering resistance at the director level, Hansen and O'Sullivan worked to integrate design thinking into Intuit's leadership training programs, applying it directly to problems that leaders faced. In one training program, an IT director was challenged to lead a team tasked with reducing company spending on employees' mobile devices by $500,000. O'Sullivan's group held a one-day session on painstorming and soul jamming for the team. The IT director achieved the desired savings and won much appreciation from the members of her team for having made their task so much easier than expected. She and the other participants in that leadership training program became fervent D4D advocates. Encouraging experimentation rather than PowerPoint has enabled employees throughout Intuit to move from satisfying customers to delighting them. Design for Delight has stuck because people see that it is an obviously better and more enjoyable way of innovating. Innovation activity has increased dramatically in the organization. Take TurboTax, Intuit's single biggest product. In the 2006 tax year, the TurboTax unit ran just one customer experiment. In 2010, it ran 600. Experiments in the QuickBooks unit went from a few each year to 40 last year. Intuit now seizes new opportunities more quickly. Brad Smith pushed for D4D-led innovation in the fast-growing arena of mobile apps, and within 24 months, the company went from 0 to 18, with a number of them, including SnapTax, off to a very successful start. Net promoter scores are up across the company, and growth in revenue and income has increased over the past 3 years. Scott Cook may not have been another Steve Jobs, but it turned out that Intuit didn't need one. Originally published in June 2011, reprint R1106E. Stop the Innovation Wars by Vijay, Govindarajan, and Chris Trimble. It was just an innocent comment. While working with a client at a Fortune 500 company, we proposed the formation of a special group to execute a new growth strategy. For now, let's just refer to the group as the Innovation Team, we suggested. The client rolled his eyes. Let's call it anything but that, he said. What is this so-called Innovation Team going to do? Brainstorm? Sit around being creative all day? Talk condescendingly about a superior organizational culture? All of this while operating with neither discipline or accountability? All of this while the rest of us get the real work done. Wow. All it took was two words. Innovation Team. In our experience, innovation teams feel a hostility toward the people responsible for day-to-day operations that is just as biting. The rich vocabulary of disdain includes bureaucratic, robotic, rigid, ossified, staid, dull, decaying, controlling, patronizing, and just plain old. Such animosity explains why most executives believe that any significant innovation initiative requires a team that is separate and isolated from the rest of the company. But that conventional wisdom is worse than simple-minded. It is flat wrong. Isolation may neutralize infighting, but it also neuters innovation. The reality is that an innovation initiative must be executed by a partnership that somehow bridges the hostilities. A partnership between a dedicated team and what we call the performance engine, the unit responsible for sustaining excellence in ongoing operations. Granted, such an arrangement seems, at first glance, improbable. But to give up on it is to give up on innovation itself. Almost all innovation initiatives build directly upon a company's existing resources and know-how. Brands, customer relationships, manufacturing capabilities, technical expertise, and so forth. So, when a large corporation asks a group to innovate in isolation, it not only ends up duplicating things it already has, but also forfeits its primary advantage over smaller, nimbler rivals, its mammoth asset base. Over the past decade, we have examined dozens of innovation initiatives and identified some best practices. In the process, we built upon foundational management theories such as Jim March's ideas about balancing exploration with exploitation, and Paul Lawrence and Jay Lorsch's argument that firms need to both integrate and differentiate corporate units. We came to the conclusion that the organizational model we prescribe, a partnership between a dedicated team and the performance engine, is surprisingly versatile. It can be adapted to initiatives that span many innovation categories, sustaining and disruptive, incremental and radical, competence-enhancing and competence-destroying, new processes, new products, new businesses, and high-risk new ventures. This article will show how to make the unlikeliest partnership work. There are three steps. First, decide which tasks the performance engine can handle and which you'll need to hand off to a dedicated team. Second, assemble the right dedicated team. Third, anticipate and mitigate strains in the partnership. Once you have taken these steps, you'll be in a good position to actually execute on your great ideas. How one company organized for growth. In most law offices, even in the internet era, you'll find libraries full of weighty and majestic-looking books. The books contain rulings from past cases. With each verdict, judges contribute to a massive body of precedents that shape future decisions. This is the system, at least in the United States and many other countries. Law students spend countless hours mastering the intricacies and subtleties of researching precedents. Idea in brief. Special teams dedicated to innovation initiatives inevitably run into conflict with the rest of the organization. The people responsible for ongoing operations view the innovators as undisciplined upstarts. The innovators dismiss the operations people as bureaucratic dinosaurs. It's natural to separate the two warring groups. But it's also dead wrong, say Tuck Business School's Govindarajan and Trimble. Nearly all innovation initiatives build on a firm's existing resources and know-how. When a group is asked to innovate in isolation, the corporation forfeits its main advantage over smaller, nimbler rivals, its mammoth asset base. The best approach is to set up a partnership between the dedicated team and the people who maintain excellence in ongoing operations, the company's performance engine. Such partnerships were key to the successful launch of new offerings by legal publisher Westlaw, Lucent Technologies, and WD-40. There are three steps to making the partnership work. First, decide which tasks the performance engine can handle, assigning it only those that flow along the same path as ongoing operations. Next, assemble a dedicated team to carry out the rest, being careful to bring in outside perspectives and create new norms. Last, proactively manage conflicts. The key here is having an innovation leader who can collaborate well with the performance engine and a senior executive who supports the dedicated team, prioritizes the company's long-term interests, and adjudicates contests for resources. West, a 135-year-old business, is one of several publishing houses whose mission is to make legal research easier. after it was acquired by the Thomson Corporation, now Thomson Reuters, in 1996, West experienced 5 years of double-digit growth as the industry made a rapid transition from printed books to online databases. But in 2001, a major problem arose. Once nearly all of West's customers had converted to Westlaw, the company's online offering, West's growth plummeted to near zero. To restart growth, West set its sights on expanding its product line. By studying its customers, law firms, corporate law offices, and law schools, among others, and how they worked, West saw that lawyers had no convenient access to many key sources of information. For example, to examine legal strategies in past cases, law firms were sending runners to courthouses to dig through dusty archives and photocopy old briefs, documents written by lawyers for judges, often to summarize their arguments. Questions to ask. When dividing the labor. 1. Does my company already have the needed skills for all aspects of the project? 2. What portions of the innovation initiative are consistent with the existing work relationships in the performance engine? When assembling the dedicated team. 1. What is the right mix of insiders and outsiders? 2. How should the team be structured differently from the performance engine? 3. How should the team be measured and incentivized? As you manage the strains on the partnership. 1. Is there a tone of mutual respect? 2. Are resource conflicts resolved proactively? 3. Is the shared staff giving sufficient attention to the innovation initiative? Starting with an online database of briefs, West proceeded to launch a series of new digital products. By 2007, West had restored its organic growth to nearly 7% annually, quite an accomplishment since its customer base was growing much more slowly. An expansion into databases for different kinds of documents does not seem, at first glance, as if it would have been a stretch for West. But Mike Wylands, then the CEO, and his head of product development, Irv Barbara, immediately saw that the briefs project, because of its size, complexity, and unfamiliarity, was beyond the capabilities of West's performance engine. Some kind of special team was needed. At the same time, Wylands and Barber were confident that portions of the project could be tackled by West's existing staff. They just had to make sure the two groups worked well together. Ultimately, the new briefs offering succeeded because Wylands and Barber built an effective partnership between a dedicated team and the performance engine, following the three steps we've outlined. Divide the labor. Step one in forming the partnership is to define the responsibilities of each partner. Naturally, you want to assign as much as you can to the performance engine. It already exists and works well. But caution is due. You need to realistically assess what the performance engine can handle while it maintains excellence in ongoing operations. The proper division of labor can span a wide range, from 10-90 to 50-50. To 90-10 splits. It depends on the nature of the initiative and the performance engine's capabilities. So, how do you decide? The performance engine has two essential limitations. The first is straightforward. Any task that is beyond the capabilities of the individuals within the performance engine must be assigned to the dedicated team. The second limitation is less obvious. It involves work relationships. What person A and person B can do together is not just a function of A's skills and B's skills. It is also a function of the way A and B are accustomed to working together. As long as A and B are working inside the performance engine, their work relationship is extremely difficult to change. It is reinforced daily by the demands of ongoing operations. BMW was confronted with this second limitation when it designed its first hybrid vehicle. See the sidebar, why BMW didn't reinvent the wheel. Therefore, the performance engine should take on only tasks that flow along the same path from person to person that ongoing operations do, at the same pace and with the same people in charge. To ask more of the performance engine is too disruptive. It embeds conflicts between innovation and ongoing operations so deeply within the performance engine that they become impossible to manage. Case study: Why BMW Didn't Reinvent the Wheel. At the heart of every hybrid automobile lies a regenerative brake. Traditional brakes dissipate the energy produced by the vehicle's motion, generating friction and useless heat. Regenerative brakes, by contrast, capture the energy and put it back to work. An electrical generator built into the brake recharges the hybrid's massive batteries as the car slows. Chris Bangle, then chief of design at BMW, was discouraged by slow progress early in the company's first effort to design a hybrid vehicle, launched in 2007. The source of the problem, Bangle saw, had nothing to do with engineering prowess. BMW employed the right experts. The problem lay in the company's formal structure and processes. Under its well-established design procedures, there was no reason for battery specialists to speak with brake specialists. There was no routine workflow between them. Bangle ultimately decided to create a dedicated team to enable the deep collaboration that was necessary among all component specialists involved in the regenerative brake design. He named it the Energy Chain Team, and it succeeded in moving the project forward quickly. Although a dedicated team was required for this one aspect of vehicle design, all other aspects of BMW's first hybrid launch – design, engineering, sales, marketing, distribution, and so forth – were handled by its performance engine. At West, Wylans and Barber recognized that although product development staffers had deep expertise in judicial decisions, such as Miranda v. Arizona, Brown v. Board of Education, Roe v. Wade, and thousands more, they had no experience in gathering briefs, which were scattered throughout countless courthouses and were much harder to track and organize than decisions were. The complicating factor was scale. There can be dozens of briefs for every judicial decision. The dedicated team, at the very least, had to take responsibility for locating and acquiring the briefs and would need a few outside experts to be effective. More critically, Wylans and Barber saw that the briefs project as a whole would be inconsistent with the work relationship within West's product development group. Composed of about 50 legal experts, the group worked on a few dozen small initiatives at a time. The typical project was an improvement to the West Law database that involved only two or three people for up to a few weeks. The group was non-hierarchical, and the individuals within it did not depend heavily on one another. In fact, during a given project, a product developer's most important work relationship was likely to be cross-functional, with a peer in the information technology group. The briefs project was much larger. At its peak, it involved 30 people full-time. The product developers needed to work together in an unfamiliar manner. Each needed to take on a specialized role as part of a tightly structured, close-knit project team. Asking the developers to operate in both modes at once would have been disruptive and confusing for all involved. Therefore, Wylans and Barber assigned nearly the entire product development task to a dedicated team. However, they assigned the marketing and sales tasks to the performance engine. Marketing and selling briefs was not much different from marketing and selling Westlaw. The buyers were the same, and the value proposition was easy to explain. The work could simply be added to West's existing marketing and sales processes. It would flow along the same path, at the same pace, and with the same people in charge. The sales and marketing teams were a component of the performance engine that could do double duty. A subset
we refer to. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.